Melanie Stai, I will teach this lecture today about simulation in place of Professor Lebudec. So we will the lecture is about simulation today, and actually we will learn how to perform correctly simulation and how to measure correct outputs from simulation. So we will see what is a simulation, and we will see different examples of simulations and how to perform each one of them. And then we will see how to measure the accuracy of the output of the simulation. And for this, we will use the confidence intervals that you are already taught. So we will see how to measure the output of a simulation. And actually, for this, we will use the confidence intervals that you are already taught. Then, in order to measure the accuracy of the output of the simulation, we will need some random numbers. And for this, we'll have pseudo-random numbers created by random number generators. So we'll see how to use the random number generators. The random number generators will be also used to sample from distributions, which is also important and necessary for performing simulations. And then we will see how tomorrow we will see how to use Monte Carlo to compute several quantities that can be expressed as expected values. So in a simulation, the true environment, the actual environment, the real environment, is replaced by the execution of a program in our computer. Let's imagine that we have a wireless sensor network where the sensors are carried by mobile users, and their aim is to send information to a central database. Then, in order to simulate this, we need to write to code to code the different processes in our program, in our computer, and then to use an instance of this algorithm for every sensor node. So the difference, basically, so the first one of the first things we need to do in order to do a simulation is to simulate the events that are parallel, the parallel events. So in real time, in the real world, there are several actions that happen in the same time, almost simultaneously. And in our simulation, in order to execute these actions, we need to serialize them. And this is done by maintaining a simulated time. So what's the definition of a simulated time? Is actually a time where we assume that all the actions, all the events in the real world take place. And by maintaining this simulated time, we can replace each action by instantaneous events, for example, start of the transmission for the sensor network. And then these instantaneous events, we assume that they cannot, it's practically impossible that they take place in the same time. So in order to better understand the simulated time, assume that for the wireless sensor network we said before, the sensors and send information to the central database, it's time that they observe a difference in their reading, a big difference in their reading, but at most every 5 seconds. Or every, yes, at most every 5 seconds. So it's very possible that two sensors will observe a difference in their readings very close in time, for example, let us assume less than 10 microseconds. And then in our code, in our program, this we will not be able to do it, to run it in 10 microseconds. So in real time, this might take more time than 10 microseconds for our program, but the simulated time will still be 10 microseconds. Okay, and then after that, there's no events, no change in the readings of the sensor takes place. So for the next 5 seconds, let us assume. And therefore, this might be very simple for our code to implement, to run, and it might take much less real time than 5 seconds. So the real time to execute this 5 seconds might be less than 5 seconds, but the simulated time will still be 5 seconds. And then our program will move to the next event. Okay? Another important issue for simulation is the initialization. So we should the state of the simulation and the output of the simulation might be affected by the initial conditions by the initial state, and it's very hard to choose and to know which initial state will be the correct one to start, the good one to start. Therefore, the solution for this is stationarity, so we should measure the output of our simulation when the simulation is in a stationary regime, not in the transient regime. We'll see this in more detail later. Let's get started with more details. So we have two simulation examples. The first one, the end customers arrive at Joe's shop and they want to download the file simultaneously, almost at the same time. And what we want to measure here is the time T it takes to serve all the end customers. Meaning that the time t that it takes that all n customers download their file, finish with downloading their files. The second example is a server, an information server, which receives some requests and serves these requests according to a scheduling policy. And then what we want to estimate is the time it takes for one request to be served. Okay, the delay for one request. So what is the difference between these two simulations? They are different, these two simulations. So the first simulation is a terminating simulation. This means that there is a condition that when this condition is satisfied, we can stop the simulation. We know that we should stop the simulation at this moment. For example, here there are n customers that arrive at Joe's shop. They all want to download the file. When everyone has downloaded the file, means that everyone is served. So we have served all customers, and therefore, then at this moment we can terminate the simulation and return the estimated time to serve all the customers, okay, T, which is will be the simulated time. So for a terminating simulator, there's a sequence of processes that need to take place in a well-defined environment. We execute these processes, and then there is a condition that when this condition is satisfied, we stop the simulation. For the second example, it's not a terminating simulation, does not terminate. So the information server receives requests, serves the requests, and then we do it for multiple requests, and then sometime we estimate the time it takes to serve one request. But we don't know when to stop the simulation. So what we have to know is when to start measuring our output for this simulation, and also when to stop the simulation. Okay? So let's see now two other simulation runs. These are non-terminating simulations, like the one for the information server that we saw. We have again an information server that has a queue, and there are requests arriving on the information server. When the server serves another request, the requests stay in the queue. Okay. So in the first scenario, if we compute here the service rate will be higher than the arrival rate. The arrival rate here is 10 requests per second. Here the service time is a little bit higher. The service rate is 1 over 96 milliseconds and is a little bit higher than the arrival rate. So in this case, initially we observe a transient state where there is a clear trend of that the queue length increases. So this axis here shows the queue length, and this axis here shows the time. So initially, the queue length increases. There's a clear trend of increasing. And then after some point, we observe these oscillations, where the queues oscillate between some busy moments and some lazy moments. And this is a characteristic of the transient state. These oscillations are characteristics of a stationary regime, stationary state. Okay. So it seems that in this simulation that the arrival rate is smaller than the service rate, the rate at which the server can serve our requests. We have a stationary regime after some transient state. Okay. In the second scenario, The arrival rate is higher than the service rate. So one over this is the service rate. And the arrival rate is a little bit higher than the service rate. So the requests arrive at a higher rate than the server can serve them. And we observe here that the queue length works to infinity. So there is no stationary regime. There are no oscillations. The queue length is increasing all the time. So there is no, we observe here that there is no stationary regime at all. So this is what I just said. It's just written also on the slide. And let's see more about the definition of stationarity now. So stationarity is a property of a stochastic model, x of t. Let's assume that x of t is a stochastic model that represents the state of our simulation at some time t. Then this is stationary if the joint distribution of the state of the simulation at 10 consecutive times, at 10 consecutive times here, xt1, xt2, xtn, is the same as the joint distribution of the state of the simulation at 10 consecutive times that derive if we shift the previous time by s. So just shift it in time. So these two vectors, they should have the same distribution if x of t is stationary, which means that the simulation does not get old. So the distribution remains the same. Okay? Now for a simulation, it is common that we can draw the future of the simulation by looking only at the state of the simulation at now, the current moment, the current time t. And this is a Markov property, when we can draw the future by looking only at the state at the current moment. We don't need the past. Okay, this is a Markov property. Therefore, we can see a simulation as a Markov chain. Now, for the Markov chains, for the theory of Markov models, if we run the simulation for long enough, then either we have a stationary regime or we walk to infinity. There is no stationary regime at all. For example, before, for the information server with the queue, we saw that when the utilization factor of the queue was higher than 1, where the utilization factor rho is defined as the arrival rate over the service rate, okay? When it was higher than 1, then the queue was unstable. Whereas when the utilization factor was less than 1, then the queue was stationary after some transient state. Now, if the state space is strongly connected, which strongly connected means that from every state I can go to any other state. Okay. So a queue has states that are strongly, the state space of a queue is strongly connected. So when the queue empties, I go to states with smaller queue lengths, and when the queue, okay. Either there is zero stationary regime, or there are no stationary regimes, or there is one single stationary regime. Now, if we have other models, not queues, but other models, other systems with failure modes, then there might be several different distinct between them stationary regimes. So we might not have a single stationary regime. So for the queue that we've seen before, there is a single stationary regime because the state space is strongly connected. Now, it's very hard to know if a system, if a model has a stationary regime. So for some models, some important models, this is solved, so we can know. For example, for the queuing system, if we have a single queue, we know we can, by the utilization factor, if it's higher than 1 or less than 1, we can say if there is a stationary regime or not. However, we can reason about our system in order to try to understand if it's possible to have a stationary regime or not. Okay, for example, if we expect for some system that there is growth or seasonality, then this is a reason for not having a stationary regime. For example, for the internet traffic, we expect that on a monthly time scale, we expect that the internet traffic will increase. So at this time scale, we may not have a stationary regime. We will not have a stationary regime. Now, if we believe that our model has a stationary regime, then we should treat appropriately the transients. So basically, we should not measure our output during the transient state. We should remove the transient state. For example, in this simulation where we have a stationary regime, this transient state, we should remove it. And we should start measure the output of our simulation from time one here. So we should measure our output based on this part of the simulation. The transient part here, where we see a clear trend of increasing, we should remove it. So we start measuring the output of our simulation when we don't observe any clear trend, for example, increasing or decreasing. We just observe these oscillations, okay? And then later in the course, so this is important because if you include the transient in the simulation, you may have non-reproducible results and wrong results, actually. Yes. Yes, so you observe your output. The only way, if you don't know if there's a stationary regime or not, then the only way is to observe your output. When you see that, so here you observe there is a clear trend, for example, increasing, or other times can be decreasing, okay? So here it increases, then it reaches a some point where it does not clearly increase, but increases, decreases, has some oscillations. So this is a characteristic of a stationary regime, okay? So you remove the initial part where you observe this clear increasing trend, or any trend, for example, decreasing, or... Yes. You need to observe the output of the simulation over time, yes. You cannot do it, yes. But you should do it because it's... sorry, I go back. Because if you have the transients in your results, then your results will not be correct, will be misleading or non-reproducible, okay? And later in the course, you will see how to possibly avoid the transients at all. But this in a later lecture. Okay. So now typical reasons for non-stationarity, so that you don't have stationarity, is, as I said before, seasonality and growth. So seasonality means that there is difference between different seasons, epochs, like, or for example, between the day and night, let's say you have difference. For example, the load, the electrical load, is different between day and different between night. Different in the day and different in the night. But this, for example, for the internet traffic, that we said that there is, it is expected an increasing trend in the monthly time scale. If you look it at the minute time scale, then this can be ignored. Okay, so in a very small time scale, this can be ignored. Or for example, if you have the electrical load and you look it at seconds, it can be ignored, although it's different between day and night. Now, other reasons for non-stationarity is if we don't have stability due to explosion. This is an example of this is the Q length that we saw before, and where the utilization factor is higher than one. So when the arrival rate is higher than the service rate, so in this case, there's no stationary regime and the Q length walks to infinity. And another reason is when you have freezing simulators, non-stability due to freezing simulation, when there are the system becomes slower with time and there are some events that are king events and that they impact a lot the system. And as if you run for more time the simulation, then the impact of this event becomes more important and affects more the system. But for this you will see them also in a later chapter, in a later lecture. Okay. So you will see the definition of these simulations later. Okay, so now a question for you. So the state of a simulation at time t is drawn at random from a distribution f. Is this a stationary distribution? So the answer is A, yes it is. And it is because the joint distribution of, if you, here you see a longer, for a longer time period, the simulation, and the joint distribution of the state of the simulation at n consecutive times, as we said before, if we shift it in time, this vector, the n state, the n consecutive states of the simulator, the simulation, if we shift it in time for any k higher than zero, then the distribution remains the same. So we cannot tell, it's impossible to see if this part is old or young, okay? So this part is older than this, but you cannot, this part is older than this one, but you cannot make the difference. You cannot say which part is old or young. And this distribution is the same as a distribution of n random variables that are drawn from the distribution f, of the vector of n, the joint distribution of n random variables that are drawn, each one is drawn independently from the distribution f. Okay? Any questions up to there? No. Okay, so now we will see how to measure the accuracy of the output of the simulation. So basically there are two different kinds of simulation again, the deterministic ones and the stochastic ones. So for the deterministic ones, there are no random parts. The simulation is performed in a very well-defined environment. There are no random components, and we just, for example, want to check the feasibility of a system. For the stochastic, but however, the environment is better modeled with random components. So the simulations will be stochastic and their output will be random. Therefore, we need to measure the accuracy of the random output using the confidence intervals. For example, in the Joe's experiment that we said before, that n customers go to Joe's shop and they want to download the file. So we do it one with n customers once. We have an output of the time, of the estimated time. If we repeat the experiment, when we do it once more, the estimated time will be different, okay, because there are random components in the simulation. So how do we compute the confidence intervals? For this, we need to use replication. Okay. So for the Joe shop, for each number of customers in the shop, we repeated the simulation 30 times. And here we have the outputs of each one of them in terms of the estimated time to serve all these, the customers. So for example, for 10 customers, we repeated the experiment, we computed the estimated time 30 times, we repeated the experiment 30 times, and we have these times, these estimated times. And the same we did for 20 customers. These are the estimated times for 30 and for 40 customers. Okay, so this is replication. We repeat the experiment many times and we compute the output for its replication. And then, based on these output values, we computed the confidence intervals for the mean and the median, as you see here. So for each number of customers, we have a confident interval for the mean and the median based on the outputs of the different replications. So now we have another question. So if we want to compute the confidence interval for the median, then this is true. We just need that the simulation runs are independent. Now, if we want to use the mean to compute the confidence interval for the mean, then we should, of course, we need that the runs are independent, but we also need to make sure that the theorem for giving the confidence interval for the mean is valid, and this needs a high number of runs. So here we have 30 runs, and we are most probably okay. So basically, we just need that our simulation runs are independent. And now in the next, we will see how to do independent runs, because it's very easy that we don't have independent runs. Okay, so we'll see now how to make our runs, our replications to be independent, which is what we need. And Now, for this, we should use random number generators. Now, a simulation generally uses needs to use random values that, of course, they cannot be truly random. So it uses pseudo-random values that are created by the random number generators. The random number generator produces a random number between following the uniform distribution between 0 and 1. And for this, the random number generator uses a chaotic sequence that actually has a single input that is the seed. And it's a chaotic sequence because changing a little bit the seed, the input, produces very different outputs. Okay. Basically, this is a periodic sequence, and it's not at all random, but it looks like random. Okay. So we will see a first example of such a sequence, such a random number generator, is the linear congruence, which is used by NS2, although it's obsolete. Actually, it's commonly used. So the sequence of producing the random numbers is this one, xn equal to this quantity here, where S is xn is the sequence of random numbers we take. Okay, so S is the seed that is given as input to the random number generator, and then these are some other parameters. A is given by this quantity, M is this quantity and satisfies this property here. And actually, what is important is that for any value of the seed, the period of this sequence is m minus 1. Okay, so the values are repeated every m minus 1 times. But we will see that this sequence looks like random. So here we have the QQ plots from the uniform distribution and our sequence, and they perfectly match, so we have linear graphs, so it looks like random. And we have the autocorrelation for different lags, and this is also like very small, negligible. So this again shows that looks like random, the sequence xn. And then we have the lag diagram for different values of h. So we plot the pairs xn and xn plus h for different values of h, where h is time. And we see that everything looks random. So there is no clear trend of dependence. There is no dependence. Okay. So the sequence, although it's periodic, truly looks like random. Okay. However, because the sequence is periodic, we should, in order to properly use the random number generator, we should ensure that the period of the random number generator is large enough and much, much larger than the times of the times that we will use the random number generator in our simulation. So the numbers that we call the random number generation in our simulation should be much less than the period of it. Okay. For example, the NS2 the linear congruence of the NS2 simulator has this period, which might be very small for a very long simulation. Whereas there is another random number generator of MATLAB, the Mersenne Twister, which has this 10 to the power of 6,000, which is a much larger period, and this random number generator should be much more suitable for a long simulation. Okay. Now let's see an example when the period is too small. So, for example, in this case, we use the linear congruence or the NS2 random number generator, and we'll see that the confidence intervals, if you see here, the confidence intervals are large, which is not correct, actually. Whereas when we use another generator, this one, Le Cuillère generator, the confidence interval becomes much smaller, which is correct. So it's important which random number generator you choose, and based on different random number generators, you might have different outputs for the simulation. So let's see now another thing that is more related to the independent runs that we mentioned before. So here in the first graph, we see two streams that are produced, we plot two streams that are produced by the random number generator. In the first stream, we use the seed 1. In the second stream, we use the seed 2. And then these streams have the same length. So we plot pairs of the streams, pairs of the values, so in the x-axis and the y-axis. And we see here that the output, they don't look random. So they are dependent one to another. So we see dependence. Okay. Whereas in the second figure, in the second graph, we created two streams, but we didn't. In the first stream, we created the first stream first, and then with seed 1, and then the second stream we used as seed the state of the random number generator when the first stream ended, so at the end of the first stream. So we produced the two streams sequentially, the one after the other. Okay, and here we plot the pairs of values of the streams. And we see here that they are not dependent, so they look completely random. And this is correct. This is what we should do. So we should not perform simulations and use streams that are created by the random number generator and are dependent, because then our simulation runs will not be independent as we require to compute the confidence intervals. Okay. So basically, in order to choose correctly a random number generator, we should be careful so that it has a period that is much larger than the number of times that we will call the random number generator in our simulation. And also, we should have if we should have truly independent streams in order to do independent runs of our simulation, okay, independent replications of our simulation. So in order to do this, it is sufficient to create to run the simulations one after the other, to create the streams from the random number generator sequentially, one after the other. This is sufficient if the random number generator has a sufficiently long period, okay. Now, this might not be practical, because if we do multiple runs of our simulation, we may want to do them in parallel, so that to earn time, to have less computational time. And in this case, we should have truly independent seeds. So how do we have, we cannot use like seed 1 and seed 2 as we seen before, we should have truly independent seeds. And for this, we either, for example, can use the clock of our computer and use as a seed the clock of our computer, or we can use inputs by the user, for example with the mouse, which might be less practical, or we can use random number generators that support parallel streams, and these are available in some tools, for example MATLAB. We will see this. So for example in MATLAB, there is this random number generator that supports parallel streams. So here we create with this function and this random number generator, we create four streams. And these, although they have the same seed and although we use the same random number generator, they are statistically independent. So we use this function, we create this S1, S2, S3, S4, and then we create four streams based on this output here. And then we see here that their correlation is very small. So they are statistically independent. Okay, so this is an example where you can use a random number generator that supports parallel streams. Another example is another way to have independent runs is to use different random number generators, which of course might not be practical again, because if you want to create a lot of independent replications of the simulation, it's not possible to have as many random generators as you need. I think we will have a break now and continue after the break. If you don't have any questions, up to there.